she's not.
Get into all kinds of other things. You're going to see it here, but I want you to see what it looks like. This is basically the scroll that I was going to take and open up, and they still have these old ones, and we're guiding. They have this, and not looking at the Western Wall, looking at the entire edifice, including these four support walls that Herod the Great built in about 19. Okay, the year 19. Herod is here in 37. He begins a great building campaign throughout the land. And then in around 19 BC, 20 BC to 20, 19 BC, he begins to prepare this hill. This is Moriah. Okay, so let's first look at this. This is Moriah. You can see that there's something been done. Okay, first of all, we see the topography. Okay, if I'm standing here, you're going to want to all stand over here. So get over there, because in a minute I'm going to be using this. Mm-hmm. So why don't you fill in over here? I just want to get the lay of the land. You have, if I'm here, okay, it's going to be, by the way, very challenging here as a Jewish believer, because most of the people that work here are very religious, and not so, even though we identify with their salaries, but getting and wanting to bring groups here. This is one of the most important edifices in all of Hebrew Jewish life, and for us as well, as Messianic believers. They do not like Messianic believers. And they don't like the mix between Messianic believers, Jews, and Christians. They don't get it. He in particular. But I have my way with him. So we're standing on the Mount of Olives and looking down to this great Mount Moriah. Okay, and if this valley would be what?
Kidron
Valley. Okay, so this would be to the north. This would be to the south. This would be the city of David. I'm facing west. Okay, east, west. This is the later buildup of the Arab quarter. Okay, so Herod is here, and he's preparing this hill. You can see there's already some expansion, but you don't see the support structures that he later builds. What we see is what those from Zerubbabel's team were able to do. Okay, so if we start from the beginning, we start with just a hill. And that's known as Moriah. And Abraham brings his beloved son Isaac. He's been asked to sacrifice. He prepares an altar. And his son he's putting his son on the altar. And he said, but Abba, where is the sacrifice? You know, he didn't know it was him. And then he sees the ram in the thicket. God provides. Solomon builds this beautiful temple, one of the most magnificent temples that the Jewish people have ever seen. And it was destroyed by the Babylonians in 586. They tried to destroy it before in 732, and finally in 721, the Assyrians lay siege of Jerusalem. Hezekiah listens to counsel. King Hezekiah listens to counsel. He knows that he is encroaching war. And what does he do? He prepares the city. How do you prepare the city? Prayer, refortification, and the diversion of water. So that during the time of siege, the people will have at least water. And they're not successful, the Assyrians, because the angel of the Lord decimates 185,000 Assyrians and when they flee, Nebuchadnezzar in 586 destroys the city of Jerusalem for the first time. It is a major devastation. And we're in exile with by the rivers of Babylon, where we wept when we remembered what? That preservation of Zion. We're in exile, we remember Zion. We're in Nazi Europe, we remember Zion. Memory, collective memory of what? Of the Kadosh, of the Beit HaMikdash, of the Lord our God. And we're in exile. And in 538, Cyrus, a Persian king from the east of Iran today. Can you imagine the rhetoric that's coming out of Iran today? And if we go back in time to the 6th century, 538, we hear about this King Cyrus says, I know your gods. You guys, I think ever since you've been here, it's been good for us. Now you can walk away from something and you return to Zion. And there is a definitive return to Zion, led by Zerubbabel, followed by Nehemiah, undergirded by Ezra as they fall on their faces, prostrate before the Lord, and courage once again, because there's the celibates and all the others that are discouraging the rebuilding of the temple, the rebuilding of Solomon's temple. And then lo and behold, 63, after all that has been transpired, including the Hellenistic period, including the time of the Maccabees, and the rededication of the temple, all of that, whoop, fast forward, end of the Hasmonean period, John, the Maccabees, the Hasmoneans, Rome, 63, Titus, Pompey is here conquering, Herod the Great is here, Herod the Great built, it's really the most exact way of saying it, and he built Herod the Banai, Agador, the great builder, asked the Jewish people, I would like to flatten the hill, I want to do some expansion here to the north and prepare for you something that is incredible. And he does so by putting up this magnificent 1,444 square meters of platform known as the Temple Mount. With support structures underneath, with cisterns so that the water, that waters that are being provided from about 8 to 11 miles in this direction towards Bethlehem and onward, which is the Jewish city at the time, there's pools called the Bayar Pools and the Pools of Solomon. Herod the Great built three aqueducts from the desert of the Judean wilderness and risen all the way to Jerusalem. And then we have the Gihon Springs down here. Okay, over here we have the Pools of Bethesda. But if that weren't up, we have the Pool of Israel. And if that weren't up, we have the Snakes Pools here. And we have the Mamilla Pool near Jaffa Gate. And they're bringing water into the city for what? For ritual day after. Ritual cleansing, the mikvah for drinking water, and of course his drainage channels that are built too. He built something quite magnificent. And okay, right over the place of the foundation stone. Okay, the foundation stone being that place where Abraham burns Isaac, where Solomon's temple is built. He removes Nehemiah's temple, the Zerubbabel's temple, and he builds this tremendous edifice that's known, okay, it's not that impressive in this model, known as the Herod's Great Temple with the courts. Okay, all, you've got access points, you're going to see some of that, we'll talk about that in a minute when I show you the digital. Entrance is here through the gate that's called Beautiful, the Eastern Gate, so it's the Eastern side, Women's Courts. Okay, the women's court is inside here. Then there's the court of Israel, and then there's the 15 steps to the Nicanor gates, the gate, the sounds of the ascent from the women's court up to Nicanor gates, and then inside Levites, and then inside priests. Cohen and Chris from the line of Aaron, and then further on inside here, the closest point to the Holy of Holies we will stand today.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Okay, so we're going to be at this point here, closest to the Holy of Holies, with the Cohen, the high priest. There is a soreg, there's kind of a fence around here, and that's the perimeter. All the nations can come up to the Temple Mount. Only Israel can come inside the courts. Mm-hmm. And there would be three classes of Israel. There would be women, first of all, and then amongst the men, there would be common Israel, Levitical priests, and Kohanic priests, for those who come from the line of Aaron. But all are welcome on the Temple Mount, access 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, which isn't the case today. Mm-hmm. Okay. Beyond that point, when we go to the Arab periods, and this is why you're going to see this, the tunnels as tunnels, because it's not really a tunnel, it's that the Arab conquering powers could care less about the Temple Mount, or could care less about Herod's support walls. They build their city, you know, they build their, in any case, it doesn't matter. They're built right up adjacent to the walls here. They are, really adjacent to the walls, also here. Mm-hmm. We're going to be standing above is the Arab quarter of today. Okay, so all this building is the city, okay? You only see this from 1967. Everybody thinks this is the Western Wall. It is the Western Wall, but it's only 12% of it. Mm-hmm. It is part of the Western Wall that we're going to see on this side tomorrow, okay? Mm-hmm. And it's going to go, it goes down at the bottom. It's the bottom is 70 feet. And so, you know, it goes like down 28 layers to get to the original Roman road that is exposed today. We have it. We have the original Roman road. And this for sure Yeshua walks. Mm-hmm. It's not for sure that Herod walks that road, because there's more archaeology indicating that it's longer than even what Josephus mentions, you know, say like more than 40 years to build. Mm. So he's already taken out of the scene, you know, Herod. Okay.